Good to go. Fantastic. Hello, everyone. We are live at FIT headquarters today in Ottawa, Canada. I am Leanne Redmond, Director of Digital Marketing here at FIT, and you're joining us for our very first Ask Me Anything session with an expert panel of CITPs in the room here. If you are new to FIT, CITP stands for Certified International Trade Professional. And it's a designation that our panelists today have worked very hard to achieve over the years. And essentially, it's an industry-backed designation that helps global business professionals, whether you're in marketing or finance and you're working for a global company, or maybe you're a startup founder or owner of a small business. It helps these types of people do their jobs with confidence, and it showcases their skills to the world. So it's an instant credibility boost as well for employers and for people in the industry. So we're here today. I'll help you get to know our panelists a little bit better and learn about them. We're here today with Jamie Huguette, Trade Commissioner on Global Affairs Canada. We are also joined today by Megan Malone, Senior Associate, Advanced Technologies at EDC. And also at the far right here, we're joined by Justin Archambault, Executive Director at Blue Crown International Strategies. Welcome, guys. If we could take a quick moment and help our viewers get to know you a little better. So if you could tell everybody a little bit about yourself and what do you do in your day job as trade practitioners?
Okay, so I guess I'll go first. I'm responsible for trade relations at Global Affairs, trade relations particularly with Iran, UAE, and Qatar. And I guess really basically what I do is I matchmake. I look for Canadian supply capability that can then be sold into one of those markets and try and make those connections.
Fantastic. So again, I'm Megan Malone. I am a senior associate in our global trade group at Export Development Canada, or EDC, covering the advanced technology sector. So EDC, for those of you that don't know, is Canada's a Crown Corporation of Canada, and we are Canada's Export Credit Agency, or ECA. So what that really means is that we help Canadian companies do business outside of Canada. So from a wide range of Canadian companies, small to large, any type of industry, that's what we're here to do, is to help you guys navigate those international markets. So my role at EDC in the advanced technologies sector is to work with Canadian companies, specifically in the areas of technology. So current kind of trending topics are cybersecurity, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things. We also do a lot in the telecom space, and we support our other sectors. So example, infrastructure, power, mining, oil and gas, etc., in finding Canadian companies with technologies to feed into these supply chains. Actually kind of similar, we do matchmaking as well. So EDC has international relationships with different companies around the world, and we leverage these relationships to introduce Canadian companies into those supply chain. So ours is a really tailored program. It's driven by the requests of our international clients and the types of technologies and solutions they're looking for, and we go back into our network of Canadian companies and hope that they're a match. So,
interesting work. Sorry, Justin.
Well, as Executive Director of Blue Crown International Strategies, I oversee a trade consultancy firm that provides comprehensive global business services to private sector and Canadian companies wishing to expand overseas. So we focus a lot on marketing and market entry strategies. We also delve into the realm of FDI in the usually in the ASEAN and Asia Pacific for major infrastructure projects. So that is my role, providing comprehensive trade consultancy services for Canadian companies.
That's great. Well, now that you know everybody a little bit better, maybe you can help people understand, why was it important for you guys to get your international business experience certified?
Well, I guess in any profession, you know, a certification helps you to move forward and to gain credibility. I think it's been a long-standing kind of discovery that we've realized that it's more than just to have a business degree, that international business takes a certain skill set, And it was only natural then for the business community, the academic community, the industry, to want to somehow recognize people that have those credentials that and those skill sets that, that allow you to be successful in the international or the global trade arena. I'll leave it to my colleagues.
Yeah. I would definitely echo a lot of the same. For me specifically, actually my background prior to the trade designation was focused around Africa and African studies, and had a lot of interest in the African continent. So what I, through all those experiences through my education and different work experiences, what I really found interested me was Canadian companies that were looking to expand into African markets. So the challenge that I faced was I had all this great Africa experience, but I didn't have any business experience and didn't have any real trade experience. So doing a little Googling, I kind of stumbled across both the program here in Ottawa at Algonquin in international business management, but I was really excited that it came with a certification in international trade. And then I guess to add on to that, after getting the certification, when I joined EDC, one of the things that I asked a few of my managers and colleagues at EDC is, you know, why the CITP designation? Why do people recognize this designation, and why do we recruit people with that certification? And a lot of people said, you know, it's one thing to do a business degree, but if you have a real interest in trade, it's great if you can actually focus your studies on just international trade. So it's good to get all the general business administration under your belt, but really trade has a whole different language, a whole different series of skills and knowledge that comes with it. And people that devote their education and their time to a certification in international trade can really prove that they've learned those skills and that they know how to speak the language and what's important, and they're aware of cultural nuances of doing international business and other things that you might not learn in a general business administration program.
Yeah, and I'll echo on that point as well, as Megan said, and Jamie as well, actually, is that with this designation, this isn't just about business, but this is also the cultural awareness that you have to have. Being able to not only conduct a flow of business, but also know how to deal with people from varying backgrounds and from varying regions around the world. You know, this program through FIT and also through Algonquin, as Megan said, and I also went through that that program myself. These courses really teach you how to conduct business, and also to have an overall grasp, a comprehensive grasp of what it takes to succeed in the field of international trade. Having the CITP designation, I think, really reflects that you've achieved a certain point, and I would argue, in a sense, it's the equivalent of when a doctor attaches MD to the end of their name. It's the title that instills trust and confidence from people when they look at you and they say, well, you know, this individual is a CITP. I know what they're talking about. I know what they're talking about. And as such, I think that it lends a lot of credibility in the field as well. It's you know, it opens doors. It's a requirement, I believe, at
various
organizations,
yeah.
Like
EDC, yeah.
The Trade Commissioner
Service,
I as well, and anybody in the private sector who really wishes to take it to that next level, to really scale their own abilities in this field. I think this is really the highest. It's the pinnacle of certification among trade professionals, not just in Canada, but worldwide.
Fantastic. If you guys think about your career so far, I know you're at various stages of them. If you can think back about one of the biggest learning experiences you've had to date, and what exactly did you learn from it for other people out there who may be facing similar obstacles in the trade world? Whoever wants to jump in. Think which one?
I mean, mine's gonna be a really a really different one, I'm sure, but I always find, and it's kind of why I mentioned cultural nuances to trade, but I had the opportunity to live and work in Rwanda for about 9 months, and I don't think you learn anything more about my cross-cultural communications class that I had to take during the FIT courses, but when I was actually in Rwanda to see how much cross-cultural communication is important in trade. And one of those experiences was we were developing survey questions for a baseline study for this project that we were working on in Rwanda. And so it was three or four of us from Canada that were part of the project, and then about four or five local Rwandans that were part of the project, and that was kind of our project team. And we were developing these survey questions, and it was funny because to us, we wanted a way to benchmark the progress of the individuals in the cooperatives and how much money they've made and how that progressed over the course of this project over the 5 years. And so one of the things, obviously, is income. Has your income increased, and is that a direct correlation to the work that the project's been doing? But for us, we said, you know, well, we can't actually ask the cooperative individuals what their income is right now, because to us, that's a very delicate question in Canada. You don't really walk up to somebody and ask them what their salary is. So we said, you know, we understand that cows are really important in Rwanda. Could we ask people how many cows they have and if they've purchased cows over the course of the 5 years? And our Rwandan colleagues said, absolutely not. They said, why wouldn't you ask them how much they make? It's fine for us to ask how much money you make, but cows are very important to individuals, and you don't really ever ask somebody how many cows they have. So it was a really interesting moment of learning, you know, what might work for us and what we might think is inappropriate to ask doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be the same way. So to take the time to have those conversations when you're doing business, no matter what kind of a business it is, if it's a project or if it's selling to your customers, you need to understand who you're selling to and who you're working with and what works and doesn't work for that market.
To avoid those cultural faux pas.
That's right. It. Yeah, yeah, you don't want to
make assumptions,
yes,
right?
Exactly.
And
create an awkward relationship when
And I think when you are proactive with your cultural knowledge as well, it really does open doors. In my experience, you know, being in, you know, I lived in Korea teaching English. I was in France serving drinks and food. I was in the Philippines raising a family. And in all of these situations, in business and in just your personal life, when you go out of your way to learn, appreciate the culture and the little nuances between your own and with theirs. When you apply that to business, I think it demonstrates a lot of respect, and it really does facilitate a lot of positive business dealings when the other side can look at you and say, you know, they understand us. They speak our language. They know how things are done.
They care.
Yeah. It's a very big sign of respect. I don't think we should underestimate that in dealing with global business. Oftentimes it's a deal maker or a deal breaker. Mm-hmm. We have how many examples of people who commit a cultural faux pas, and that is the end of the deal right there.
Yeah.
And on the other token, you know, when you're able to really, put yourself in their shoes and demonstrate that you've taken the initiative to, you know, to really get to the root of what their culture is, whether it's in meetings or whether it's just, you know, in regular correspondence or the way that you conduct your own business. It really does, it makes a huge difference. And a lot of countries that I've dealt with, they would look at that and say, you know, they understand us, so we're going to go with them because it's easy to deal with them.
Mm-hmm.
We can deal with them.
Yeah.
And that's that's one big piece of advice I think that is absolutely crucial for anybody launching into a career in trade. The other thing is that I wanted to mention, and I really can't say enough about this, based on my own experiences as well, is get out there and network. Because networking is going to open doors, and you're going to have to put yourself in some very uncomfortable situations where you approach people who are, you know, who are veterans in the industry, and you might feel nervous approaching them. But when you go up and when you achieve a level of CITP, for me at least, it gave me a lot of confidence, and it gave me the knowledge and you know, the ability, self-ability to go out and do this and know this is exactly what, you know, I know what I'm talking about. And putting yourself in some uncomfortable situations can really increase your confidence, not just for networking, but for a lot of other aspects in conducting business. And so I think that's a tremendous skill to have, and especially when you are doing business, there is still something to be said for a face-to-face interaction. Don't be afraid of rejection. If you get rejected, just keep on going back and try again. Just make sure you have a great elevator pitch, and make sure that what you're selling or what you're trying to accomplish is just very concise, and it stands out from the rest of the crowd.
That's great. Lots of valuable learnings here. I just want to expand on the topic of cultural faux pas. What would you do if one actually happened? Any advice for people out there, if you've made a cultural faux pas with an international client, how do you come back from that? Is there coming back from that?
I'm sure I've made a lot, so perhaps more than everybody else at this table combined.
You don't have to be specific, but
and I don't know that I want to, nor my employers would like me
to
come up with details, and maybe they don't know about
all
those.
Opinions are
maybe they don't know about those football yet. But you know, you can almost tie it in with the last question, and you know, so I'm not going to give you a detailed example, but I think the thing is that, you know, what do you do if you get caught with in a situation where there's cultural faux pas? I think a lot of it has to do with business is all about relationships, and so my two colleagues here talked about what they learned through the program and what they learned through FIT and becoming a CITP, and I think what a lot of it is not so much a recipe or a set of instructions on how to get through various situations. It's giving you a thought process. It's teaching you how to analyze situations. It's teaching you how to be flexible. It's teaching you how to react to those various situations. And so, you know, you go through the BCom program or an MBA program. What the Global Business Program does is it really does teach you, give you an idea of what to expect. And from that basis, then you can prepare yourself so you don't get caught. Okay, well, we still get caught in these situations, but at least you are somewhat aware and you can prepare yourself for them in advance. And I think that's probably the most important part of that program, is it teaches you how to react, and in a good way.
And what questions to ask, too, and like what to be mindful of.
To hopefully avoid those situations
exactly,
in the first place.
Exactly,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, we have a question came in from one of our viewers, Pavel Aul. What niche industries in Canada have global appeal and provide opportunities for Canadian businesses? For anyone on the panel. Thank you for your question.
Yes. I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to say there are some really interesting natural food products that are coming out. One thing I'd like to bring up, and I saw this great idea a few years ago, and I'm sure it's just gone around, you know, it's spreading around like wildfire, when somebody came up with the genius idea of taking air and bottling it and then selling it in China for about $30 a jar, so somebody could breathe fresh air in China. So as far as consumables go, there was one thing that really struck me when I heard about it about a year ago, maple water. And so we have maple syrup, which is just basically boiled down maple water. And maple water, there's a tremendous amount of health benefits that are associated with it, similar to what coconut water would be in some parts of the world. And so if we could leverage maple water, anybody who's producing this might be able to market it properly, not even necessarily in Canada, but overseas, where Canadian products are seen as, you know, premium, high value, and there's a lot of money to be made, a lot of potential, high margin profit that could be earned on this. And so that I'll just go out and use that one product as an example.
I like that. We're Canadian, it works. As many businesses moved to sell products online, what do they need to know regulation-wise if they're opening their e-commerce shop to international markets?
Oh, wow.
These are tough ones. I'll actually use that as a plug for maybe both the Trade Commissioner Service and EDC, because that's a question that I know. That I know that our export. So at EDC, we have a team that's called Export Help. That's literally there to answer these types of questions. So it's literally exporthelp@edc.ca if you ever have a question.
Put it up on the screen later.
I know that that's something that we get asked a lot. And I know that the Trade Commissioner Service actually has a whole guide on doing e-commerce online, especially as it relates to China, because that's one of the biggest markets and biggest competitors for e-commerce, as a lot would know. So I might actually just suggest that, you know, reaching out to different partners and government partners that have kind of this information, that collect that information, that build these guides, that might be a good start to learning some of these nuances. And they're all tailored really for Canadian companies as well. So I think that might be a good place to start to learn some of the stuff. I know Shopify also does quite a bit of material to help other companies entering e-commerce understand the market.
I think there's a lot of resources out there. You know, you've got your government resources, EDC, the Trade Commissioner Service, the provincial organizations. There's also all the trade associations, and a lot of them in Canada are very, very strong. They can highlight a lot of the opportunities that are out there. But, you know, I'm certainly no expert on e-commerce, but I do know that, you know, there are resources out there that you can go to get that information. That'd be my suggestion.
When people are entering a new market for the first time, any common errors that people make, or anything you think people should know as they can make that very important decision?
Even the slightest error can result in disaster, and so you really have to do your due diligence on everything entering a new market. I think we've dwelled on the cultural aspects of it first. You know, you just have to figure out what type of marketing strategy is going to work. You just don't enter the foreign market assuming that what works in one place will work in another.
I think there's so many examples of that, even going into the U.S. for Canadian companies.
For sure.
Not to jump in, but you know, the U.S. itself is so different from Canada in many ways.
Absolutely.
So it's often mistaken.
Yeah. For sure. Mm-hmm. And you know, even despite those differences, you know, they're even more vast when you get outside of North America. You've got Canada jumping into, you know, a place like Vietnam, for example, where, you know, there's a lot of similarities, but a heck of a lot more difference. And you really have to, you know, watch the type of marketing you do. Even, you know, just really doing your due diligence on any sort of partner, distributor, you know, if you have, you know, an agent that you deal with, you just really have to make sure that everything aligns and everything is done perfectly before jumping in, because even the smallest little thing can create a recipe for absolute disaster. Jamie, what do you
think? I would agree with that. I think like preparation, you talk about due diligence. I take it back maybe even a step further. Mm-hmm. And you know, for companies that are going to the US the first time or into Central America or wherever it might be, I think it's preparation. I think it's knowing how those business relationships work. You know, you mentioned about you can't ask somebody how many cows they have. I'm a Western Canadian boy, I would think nothing of asking anybody how many cows they have, and they certainly, I don't think they would be offended about it, but those are the kinds of things you really need to know your and how that cultural sensitivities can be applied to your particular industry or the business that you're going in. And then the other thing is, so, and we see this a lot of times in the Trade Commissioner Service, is be prepared to be reactive to. Mm-hmm. Just like going to a job interview, you want to think about what the questions are going to be ahead of time. Yeah. Have some prepared answers so that you look like you're ready in that market. We hear time and time again from foreign customers that they got all this traction, they met up with some Canadian companies at a trade show, or they met up some of the Canadian companies on a trade mission, and there was no follow-up afterwards.
Yeah.
And so if you're going to go into a market, I think it's of utmost importance to be prepared to follow up.
Sure.
And make sure that you're not stepping into that market if you're not prepared to follow up. If it's just market research, be clear that that's what you're, and make sure that your activities are around just doing market research. If you're going to try to develop a presence in that market, be prepared to follow up.
Yeah, I would also understand your competitors in that market, and I think you know, these can all sound really overwhelming, especially maybe for a small to medium-sized business that doesn't necessarily have the legs or capacity to take the time to do the research, to find all of the resources and so on. So again, I think it's another plug again for kind of leverage those organizations like the TCS, like your trade commissioners, like EDC, like FIT. But, you know, I think there's lots of great online material to Trade Ready, obviously, expert-wise, but you can find another company that's done something similar to you. And there's been quite a few instances where I've spoken to small companies and they said, you know, I found someone that did something similar or that entered a similar market, and just having that one person to connect with and bounce ideas off of, or someone in market that you trust, that, you know, can help guide you and maybe bridge that gap a little bit sooner. But looking at what your competitors are doing is one way too to really get an idea as to what's working and what's not working, what's failed and what's succeeding.
And I think it's important to know too. EDC is that EDC's got people around the world, just as the Trade Commissioner Service has people. There you go.
Just so kind.
just as the Trade Commissioner Service has people around the world, and that really is what their role is,
just
is
it.
To help them to make those connections.
Market.
Yeah, to understand the market, but to even make those connections. Hey, company XYZ just went into this market last year. Now, it doesn't necessarily have to be sector specific or the same industry that you're going into, but there's a lot of lessons that they can teach you. Don't ask people how many cows they have.
Yeah.
And that's the kind of intel that you're not going to get from a textbook, but you can at least learn from the FIT program that you need to ask that type of a question.
Yes. I don't think I have anything else to add.
That's
on
okay. Let's
trade consultants. Yes, exactly. Yeah. Go to the experts.
Yeah.
Go to the experts. At Global Affairs Canada, Trade Commissioner Service, and Export Development Canada, or Blue Crown International.
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to change gears a little bit. I enjoyed the love fest that's happening here. With all of the rapid changes right now in tariffs, trade policy, how do you keep on top of regulations, and how do you mitigate the risks?
Yeah, I mean, again, I would say for me, it can be really overwhelming, and I honestly leverage a lot of the online content. So again, subscribing to material like Trade Ready, like ExportWise, other types of online trade content that keeps you up to date on those. The expert help team at EDC gets a lot of those questions too. So especially as it relates to, you know, what's happening in the US, what should I be concerned about? What do I need to be aware about? Those are questions that we get constantly, and a lot of the time, we'll provide material on that, but we'll also connect to trade commissioners and to other entities that are working on staying on top of these matters and have more expertise in that.
Okay.
So leverage your network and leverage, you know, other organizations that that stay on top of that material.
I think risk mitigation at this point, when it comes down to getting to the root of expanding in trade. And, you know, a lot of Canadian companies are sometimes a little bit afraid to go into the corners.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we tend to stick to markets like the U.S., Europe, China. But I mean, when you look at the opportunities in a lot of areas around the world, you get down around, you know, Southeast Asia, which has tremendous growth rates at this point. You've got an entire continent in Africa that's becoming, you know, it's, I'm sure you can attest that it's, there's a lot more. Lots more opportunities now. And so it's happening all over the world, and I think Canadian companies really need to diversify their portfolio by location and not be afraid to really take a plunge into emerging markets and developing markets. And
I think that's exactly kind of what EDC is there for, is to help Canadian companies mitigate those risks. So there's lots of products that can help Canadian companies do that. Like, obviously, if you're going into a new market and you're dealing with a new customer, there's always a risk that you won't get paid. So there are things like credit insurance, not only that EDC provides, but there's a whole private market that does that as well. There's political risk insurance to kind of, when you're going into these markets that are maybe unstable or things could change rapidly and you have assets or, you know, you're just operating there, you want to make sure that you're insured and you're protected. So, you know, there is a lot of resources out there to help mitigate those risks of doing business outside of Canada.
Yeah, I think diversification is key mm-hmm. to that. I think the other part of that, the preemptive part of that, you know, before you even diversify, is intelligence. And you spoke to that in terms of EDC and the Trade Commissioner Service. I mean, again, we've got people on the ground. They track these things in market. They know the political risk. That's their job. I mean, you can do it from your laptop at home by, reading the news, and the trade magazines, and things specific to a geographic area. But I mean, there's nothing for having somebody on the ground in that market. A lot of small, medium-sized businesses can't afford to do that. Or if you're going into the market for the first time, you're not going to go and move there for 6 months and wait. So it's really key to have that network, which you spoke to earlier, and also have people in that market that you can ask. And that's where EDC and Trade Commissioner Service really plays a role.
Anything to consider on the startup side of things as they try to enter international markets for the first time, different level of budget, different level of experience? Any thoughts on how that would be different?
Jamie, this is your baby, I think.
Jamie.
Well, you know, we see a lot of, more and more, we're seeing a lot of companies that are starting right from get-go. It used to be the traditional business model was you get your backyard in order and you make sure your domestic sales are in order before you attempt to go abroad. And we're seeing companies now that are starting up and they have no intention, sometimes they have no intention of even selling in their domestic market. It just happens to be the place that they are operating from. I don't know that I would make a distinction between a bricks and mortar or a tangible goods type of business versus a services business versus an e-commerce or the startup businesses. I think it's equally important that they get those same networks and they come up with those same risk management strategies.
I'd say too, like, there's so many startup resources, especially now, that keep developing. There's so many, you know, like different organizations, like in the tech space, lots of startups go through accelerators and different types of accelerator programs, and those entities that provide these programs are really connected with the greater networks as well. So by going through kind of a startup program, you get connected to all of these different partners and players and services. Exactly.
Yeah.
So I think those are really, really great. And also, I think it's interesting because a lot of, also in the tech space, a lot of startups now really are online. So, everything is tech, everything's connected, everything's on the internet. So a lot of companies don't actually think of themselves as exporting if they're, you know, a service provider or if they have a software or an app or whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what the important thing to realize is the minute your customer is outside of your home market, so you're based in Canada, your customer is outside of Canada, whether it's the U.S. or, you know, Europe or Africa, you are exporting.
It's
you
that
are
term
selling
exporting,
a product,
right?
Exactly.
That's kind of
yeah.
hard to reposition
yeah.
us, those terms.
Exactly. It's not the product moving across the border. It's where your customer is located that defines you as an exporter.
Yeah. And even those people who are in those non-traditional roles that you may not associate with trade, being in marketing, being in finance for an international company, we've had interesting conversations.
Exactly. So just because you're a startup doesn't eliminate you from the opportunity to leverage some of those other expert resources that are there.
Makes sense. We don't need to get into specifics on this one, but how can you make sure that you get paid in a foreign market? So in other words, how do we mitigate some of those risks?
In all seriousness, EDC really is the best way to mitigate any type of risk, you know, as Megan mentioned. Political risk, commercial risk, any time that you send a product over and you're afraid of not getting paid, or whether you're fearful that, you know, there's going to be some social unrest and something could happen. And especially when you get into, you know, to use hockey analogy, when you go into the corners and you muck it up, and you're digging for the puck, you're in some pretty, you know, some murky areas. And that is where you really need to go and see EDC to really make sure that you're not going to lose your entire stock of product or any money that you invest in. So
I would say, are there any spoiler alerts that we can give some folks out here in terms of some of the basic tips and strategies, at least where to start, you know, as they kind of foray into maybe calling or someone down the line, but where can people start some initial best practices?
Yeah, well, so I guess I'll jump back quickly to the getting paid question, because
yes.
I think the answer really is credit insurance. It's maybe that's it doesn't sound straightforward, but the definition of credit insurance is your credit is you getting paid, so to ensure that you actually get paid. So whether it's EDC or the private sector that offers credit insurance, that's really a solution that will help you get paid. The other benefit of credit insurance, and one of the things that, you know, well, I always, when I was an account manager at EDC, I always thought it was an interesting viewpoint, is that if you submit a request for EDC to cover one of your new customers say it's in the US, I have a new customer in the US, I want to make sure, you know, I have to pay them, or they have to pay me 30 days after I've shipped my product or service or software. So there's a risk that in that 30 days you're not going to get paid, but that new customer already has your product or service. And now what do you do? Because you've already, they now have a hold of it, they can use it, they can, you know, replicate it, and you still haven't gotten paid. So if you submit that request to EDC, and for whatever reason, we have a red flag, because we look into all of the credit risk of that company before we approve covering you, just as any other insurance provider would do. So if we come back to you and we have a red flag and we say, you know what, we really don't trust this company, we suggest that you either demand that they pay you up front or you don't do business with them. But I think that's a really useful tool as a company that, you know, maybe you don't have insight into what your buyer or what your new customer is like credit-wise, but an insurance provider would come back to you with kind of a suggestion of, you know, maybe it's not a good idea to allow them to pay you on credit terms. Maybe you need to look at asking them to pay you up front.
I think EDC is great and they've got those programs.
Yeah.
But I think even before that, it comes back to that relationship. You want to make sure that you as a company are doing your due diligence.
Yeah.
You don't want to pull that trigger with EDC and say, look, bad relationship's gonna stop, I'm not getting paid.
It's
just like any type of insurance, automobile insurance, car insurance. You buy it to insure you, get that money if a bad situation, if something should happen.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, you know, there is a certain amount of an onus on the company to do their due diligence prior to pulling that trigger. It's something that's there in case you need it, but you certainly shouldn't be using it as a tool for every single transaction that you do when you go abroad.
Right.
Is going to be, you know, covered by EDC. That's not the way EDC operates. That's not the way they operate. So.
It's just an add-on.
Essentially,
you know, it's a tool to mitigate risk, but the onus, as you mentioned, Jamie, really does fall on the company.
Yeah, and that comes back to developing those networks through EDC, through trade commissioner service.
Different types of trade tools, like in trade finance, for example, you will learn the different types of payment methods that you can negotiate in a contract or whatnot. So,
absolutely.
Taking some courses, got it.
Yeah.
So for small to medium enterprises that may be watching, how do they decide, or how should they decide, in your opinion, what services to outsource versus bring in-house?
Well, I mean, it all depends on, you know, what are the skill sets, you know, what are your core competencies. I mean, if, you know, for me, my weakness might be in finance, my strength might be in marketing. So, you know, if I don't feel confident in my ability to do finance, then I would probably want to outsource that. You know, you really just have to know, you know, your strengths and your weaknesses, and kind of do a, you know, SWOT analysis in a sense on yourself, on your company, and figure out what you need somebody else to do for you.
Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities,
threats for those who may not have not done business. I think too, there's a lot of great free resources. So, you know, like, definitely echoing the same thing that Justin said, if I'm a tech genius and I've come up with this great product and, you know, I know all the coding and technical kind of part of it, but I'm not so keen on networking and business development and being in front of people. Like, I really like to, you know, focus on the technology. Then yes, I'm going to look for maybe even a co-founder that has kind of more of that business development experience and passion. But I think too, there's lots of great free online resources, especially for, you know, managing your social media, managing marketing, CRMs, different things like that. So doing a bit of digging as to what you can find for free.
Gotcha. In terms of intellectual property, how can people work to protect theirs and abroad?
That's a very good question. Well,
let's see.
Well, I mean, the important thing is if you really believe in your product, and if you're going to, even if you're not going to that specific market at the time, you might just want to register your trademarks and your intellectual property before even going in with the product or service. You know, domain name registration, business name registration, just get everything in there, and it might cost you a little bit, but at least you can, you have some recourse in those other markets. And, you know, on a larger scale, I guess maybe this is something that in the upcoming FTAs that Canada's looking at, you know, there's always a point of contention with IP issues in, you know, agreements like, you know, NAFTA, the CPTPP. There's always that clause where, you know, intellectual property rights become a pretty contentious issue. So, mm-hmm. you know, companies can, you know, take the initiative maybe through, some lobby groups to, you know, really fight for inclusion of intellectual property rights in these FTA agreements.
I go back again, you know, to what I was saying earlier about relationships. And I think it's really important to know who you're selling to and how they're going to use that. Unfortunately, a lot of this involves money, you know, protecting your property, your IP. And so, you know, the relationship side of things is really important. I think it's also really important for SMEs that are planning. So at the early stages, when you first come up with that grandiose idea that's going to be changing the world, you really need to kind of be forward-looking and think, where are the markets that this product is going to be most successful in? And try to plan ahead, because it's a lot easier to do that early on and protect your product. And most small medium-sized businesses can't protect their business globally, or protect their products, right? Their business or their product globally. So they really do have to pick and choose where they're going to protect it. I think it's important early on for those SMEs to do that analysis and figure out, you know what, not today, but 2 years or 3 years or 5 years down the road globally, here's the three markets that I really need to protect myself in, because that's where my product is going to be popular. And go about it that way. And cross your fingers. And,
that makes sense.
Be nimble.
Where should people start planning their international supply chain? Should they be working with freight forwarders or consultants? Where do you start with that?
Where do we start with this answer?
Well, I think I don't mind taking a stab at it. I think I taught a supply chain course once. I think supply chains, we have to look at them as a whole, and you can spend a lot of time looking at your supply chain and trying to figure out, the whole idea is to find the weak spots and try and strengthen those up. So you got to find, for lack of a better term, the low-hanging fruit, the spots that can make the biggest impact. I don't think there's a formula for that you can apply to all companies. I think you really do have to look and see what you're doing, what your competitors are doing, where they're moving, what markets are moving to, what new attributes they're offering for their product and or service or whatever it might be, and try and adjust your supply chains that way. I mean, I think a lot of being in business and being competitive relies on intelligence, and not in more than market intelligence, and knowing where the markets are shifting. That it goes back to the trade policy question. Where are the tariffs coming into play, and who's going to pay me, who's not, what's happening in a particular country, is it going to be are a bunch of barriers going to be put up, and I don't want to be in the market. It all comes down to kind of knowing where the market, or your industry is shifting to, and trying to make those changes.
Doing an analysis of also what are the kind of roadblocks in your supply chain, what's working really well and what's not. And like you said, what can you look to address those roadblocks or address, you know, kind of those points of that are slowing you down or that are costing you more money?
A lot of times that comes, those problem areas are highlighted when you're talking to your potential customers. And gee, I really like the product, but if only I could get my delivery dates pushed up 3 days, or if only you would offer in-house financing or training or whatever it might be. A lot of times those are the kind of the nuggets of information that you, if you've got enough interest, you should be acting on those. Change your supply chain to incorporate those ideas. Absolutely.
Yeah, and just like Jamie had mentioned, and Megan dwelt on it as well, is just really weed out the inefficiencies. Find out what works and what doesn't, and just try and, you know, try and make it as efficient as possible. Look into, you know, a third party that provide integrated and comprehensive, you know, supply chain logistics. It's if you have the capacity to do that, you know, let somebody else take care of it for you, because you can get an expert to handle it, and you know, you really just make your entire supply chain more efficient that way.
Yeah. Well, I think the viewer asked essentially where, you know, mentioned freight forwarders. Do we start with freight forwarders? Well, I mean, that's a good point too. Just like you run your household and you renew your insurance policy every year, or you know all the services, your cable, you look at that and find out, you know, is the best pack? Am I buying the best pack? Am I getting the best price? It's the same thing. Small businesses need to set aside time. As busy as they are, they need to set aside time, and I don't know what that time is, every 2 years, every 3 years, every 5 years, to look back and see who is feeding into the supply chain. Who am I using to ship my products to Europe? Who am I using to as an account? Where is all this stuff coming together, and can I get a better deal?
And are they, you know, is the failure rate, you know, are you getting these products, are they arriving undamaged, are they arriving on time? You have to have some sort of control mechanism in there just to, you know, to get up to your own standards. And if they're not providing that, and you can get a better deal, then
absolutely.
I think, you know, you do have to have periodical reviews to make sure that you're getting the best bang for your buck.
How would a business determine whether or not they need an export license, and how do they get one if needed? Are there free? I bet there's free resources to help them. But in your opinion, kind of where does someone start? How do you know if it's needed?
Again, the government agencies. Like, I'm sorry to keep plugging it back, but that is kind of what your government's there for, is to help guide you with that.
But there are kind of criteria, like as if a business.
Yeah.
Like, how do I know if I need one versus?
And I know even like. Sounds funny, but the Canadian Border Services Agency has a lot of resources around that too. I mean, obviously that's a little bit more actual moving product across a border as opposed to something that goes over the internet. But you know, these are the people that deal with this stuff all the time. So.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't think there's an easy answer to that, because you have to know your product or your service, and depending on where you're going in the world. And I deal with this on a daily basis with some of the Middle Eastern countries that I deal with. And you really do have to know what your product or service is, and whether it's, and it doesn't have to be anything nefarious, you know, it doesn't have to be weapons or anything like that. It could simply be food products, it could be medical products, it could be culturally sensitive products, artwork, and things like that that the government wants to protect or keep within the country. So you really do need to know what your product or service might be. Whether it falls in one of these categories, it's sensitive, that may or may not be a product that needs an export certificate. And then, of course, I almost get a feeling that it's my boss that asked this question. and they're testing me right now.
Test question. You have a job.
And the official line is, the Government of Canada cannot provide a legal opinion as to whether a product or service can be. And you really do, I mean, quite seriously, at some point, you do have to rely, or the government has to rely on. Your own interpretation of what that product is going to be used for and what it is, and figure out whether you need a permit.
Yeah, I think we saw that controversy arise, and I don't know, Jamie, maybe this isn't something you can speak to, but with the controversy about the, I believe it was the tanks that went to the UAE a few years ago.
They were light armored vehicles.
Light armored vehicles. You know, this is, these are things I think that you brought up where you know, there's a lot of sensitivity that goes into the, you know, these products moving out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And what they're being used for is important.
Yeah. So are they intended for that purpose or for perhaps more nefarious purpose?
Yeah, I guess the point that I was trying to make was that you don't, the manufacturer, the seller of that product knows the best in this equation as to what that product is and what it's going to be used for. And so you really do, at that point, have to get your lawyers involved because it's all legalese and you have to get them to read through it and see whether or not you are in contravention of any of these sanctions or any other laws that are out there that allow you or don't allow you to export that product.
Yeah, and I think the Canadian Commercial Corporation, if I'm not mistaken, would be able to
facilitate
on the larger infrastructure stuff.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
What is the most common question that you get time and time and time again?
Well, I've got a few recently
with
everything happening to our neighbors down south. Say the most common question nowadays would be, you know, what's going on? How bad is it going to be for Canada? How will it affect us? It's no easy answer. It will certainly have a huge effect, particularly with obviously with steel and aluminum and with any talk about automotive. I think automotive would be devastating if these tariffs went through.
And so, prepare? Is there anything that they can do to kind of mitigate?
Diversification is key. Not putting all your eggs in one basket,
right.
Obviously, definitely helps if you have partnerships around the world or customers around the world. It makes you less vulnerable if one of the countries that you're operating in goes under, for example, or something comes up there.
Jamie, do you have.
I don't know that I get any, you know, standard questions. They kind of run the gamut. I don't know that I want to touch on that.
Yeah, it's okay.
I think we've kind of said diversification. You know, be prepared. A lot of the companies that are operating in those sectors are well aware that they're a target when we start talking about trade barriers, we talk about tariffs and things like that.
I'd also say another one is a lot of companies just say, you know, there's almost too many resources out there, especially in Canada. We have a great network of resources for companies, but in a way, there's almost too many. And, I'll say it, like the government offers tons of different resources, and as government partners, we recognize too how difficult it can be for companies to navigate everything that's offered, and where do I start? Who do I talk to? And which body is going to be useful for me? And is it BDC? Is it EDC? Is it TCS? Is it NRCI?
More acronyms,
like who?
Right?
Yeah, who do I go to? And I think I know from EDC standpoint, the one thing that we always say is if you're looking to do business with a customer outside of Canada, then that's considered exporting, and feel free to come talk to us. Talk to the Trade Commissioner Service. But I think the question is just start with one, and really it's our role to understand the greater network and connect you with the other partners.
Yeah, I would add to that. I would just say, planning.
Mm-hmm.
I think, the whole idea comes down to focus. There is a ton of resources out there, and the government, both federal, provincial, and municipal, has all kinds of resources, and so how do you weed through this stuff? And so I think as a small business person, you really do have to kind of figure out what you're going to focus on.
Mm-hmm.
And I know on the export side, we'll often get people coming to us and say, we just got a call or we just got an email from a customer in some far-flung country that we've never done business to, how do we go about shipping to them? And I think that those types of companies really do have to ask themselves, are they taking a shotgun approach to their exports?
Mm-hmm.
And just, and with the internet, of course, for the last 20 years, it happens all the time. It's so much easier now than it was 25, 30 years ago to rely on their shotgun approach. I think small business really has to focus, and they have to be prepared to turn down some of these potential opportunities because they may be more worried. work than they're worth, and then that just leads you into this dark cave of all of these resources. What do I need? What don't I need? And then you get overwhelmed. And so I think for me, it's focus, and then perhaps even rolling that back into the FIT program and plan. Make, like, if it doesn't, if that opportunity
plan,
doesn't,
do your business
fit
plan, do your
into
marketing
those plans,
plan.
Absolutely.
Don't avoid the business
if
plan.
The opportunity doesn't fit into that, then
maybe
you
need
to
question
either reconsider your plan,
yeah.
but reevaluate it, and maybe say, "Sorry, I'm going to wait."
And maybe it will fit in. You might have these tremendous opportunities in a place where you never imagined a product or service could take off.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, like Jamie said, you really want to maximize your time, your efficiency in dealing and researching into what you need to enter that market. And so, you know, you have all of these materials coming in. And one thing I'll stress is that, you know, both EDC, the Trade Commissioner Service, I think are probably the, you know, the most legitimate of the bunch. That's where you really want to get your information, the authorities on this. Once you do have that information, you come up with a basic idea, then you could, you know, look into you know, a private company to handle that legwork for you. You know, it just determine on your own first if it's really worth going in, as you said.
Okay, we have a few minutes left, so if anybody has any last minute questions, throw them in. Now's the time. We have some acronyms to throw at you. We were talking about that early. I have a question. Can certification like CIFA, CITP, PLOG really help me get a job or project? Do companies really care, or is the focus more on experience?
It's, well, Jamie, you can attest now. I think the Trade Commissioner Service, part of the requirement is anybody coming into the TCS now must have CITP.
Yeah, there's an obligation to complete that, absolutely.
Yes.
Third ones are hired, absolutely.
So, I mean, experience, sure, absolutely, in any job it goes a long way. You know, but with CITP designation, I don't know, you know, with PLOG and all of that, I'll just speak to CITP for the time being, but it's certainly a tremendous asset that, you know, it, for me, in my experience, I found that when I deal with people in government, in diplomacy, in industry, when they see the CITP title beside my name, if they recognize what it is and they're familiar with FIT, they will look, and I'm taken a lot more seriously than I was before. I think that's definitely a tremendous asset to have any time that you have an additional title beside your name, and especially with an organization like FIT, who does have partnerships with both EDC, Global Affairs, the World Trade Association, and there's another one as well with the TCS.
Yeah. I would just add, like, I think it's just, yes, having a certification in what you're passionate about or the field that you're operating in for sure gives you more credibility, because, like, kind of, you know, my manager had told me when I had asked the question about CITPs and, you know, why is CITP designation an asset for certain jobs at EDC? Because you will see it in the postings from time to time. You'll see it in the TCS. You'll see it in, you know, TFO Canada. So why is that the case? And, you know, it all goes back to, well, because you have, by having a certification in that field, you've proven that A, you're passionate about that, so I'm passionate about trade because I took the time and frankly put the effort and money and et cetera into trade and learning about it and getting certified in that. And you know, it'd be the same with an accounting designation. You put time and effort and money into kind of proving that this is what you're passionate about, this is what you want to do business in.
Yeah.
And you want to be looked at as a reliable individual in that field. So I definitely think certifications help prove that that's a field that you're interested in.
I think there's two things, really. You know, there's number one, it gives you knowledge, and it's an indicator that you have that knowledge,
mm-hmm.
and you've been trained, and you've got the skills. I think the other side of it, though, that is often overlooked, and I get a lot of young people asking me this, like, well, what do I need a CITP designation for? So-and-so doesn't even know what it is, or whatever. And I think the thing is that it provides you, it certainly indicates that you've gone through a program and you've got that knowledge and skills.
Mm-hmm.
But the other thing is it's that secret club,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's a network, it comes back to networking. And you've got that group now that you can ask a question to, and FIT does a really good job of bringing that network together. I mean, we didn't
certainly
know each other
exactly.
before today,
yeah.
and we automatically know something. We've got something in common that
yeah.
we can talk about because we both got our CFTP designation. And I think
it's
a group, it's a family, it's a network that you can go to and ask questions. And that might be the most important, the most valuable part of it.
I mean, it could be, for job opportunities for new CITPs or aspiring.